We are here tonight to finish the book of Acts. We have been in this study for a number of months now. We are now ready for the last half of the very last chapter. So if you could be finding a Bible and turning with me to Acts chapter 28, that would be awesome. I'll try to have the text on the screen as we normally do. But especially if you're joining us on the phone, or even if you have your computer open, or however you're watching class tonight, if you have a copy of the Bible with you, that would be the best. And we will be there in Acts chapter 28, the last half, in just a few minutes. Just give the weekly reminder that if you can be with us this coming Sunday morning, either at 9 or 11, be sure to sign up online if you can, and I hope all of you can also be present for the class at 10 o'clock. In between those two services, we are continuing looking at the exploits of King David. And I have truly enjoyed teaching that class for the past 2 weeks, but I am really, really, really hoping John is able to be back with us this week. 2 weeks ago when John texted, I think I said something to the effect that I would be happy to do it, but I was somewhat concerned as to whether the church could endure 3 doses of Baxter in a single week. You have now had 6 doses of Baxter in a 2-week period, so 2 sermons and 4 Bible classes, so I really hope you are hanging in there. Don't give up. Help is on the way. Hopefully there'll be some relief for you, and hopefully John will be back with us this coming Sunday if at all possible. So that's my hope. That's my prayer, and we got a lot of people going through some health struggles and some treatments that are ongoing. Hate to mention by name publicly like this in this format, but you know who you are, we know who you are, and you are in our prayers, and we certainly hope that it is effective and that it is going well. Before we get started tonight, I want to share another behind-the-scenes type picture. It has been a while. I think this might be why I enjoyed teaching the Sunday class the past couple weeks. I got to see actual human beings as I was teaching, which was really cool and kind of strange for me, but in a good way. But I'm in here today with my plants, and I've got the shade pulled down over the window to try to cut down on some of the glare on my glasses. And so instead of looking at all of you, I am looking at a tiny green dot on my laptop, the MacBook screen here. So this is just, it is not the same. I like being with all of you in person, but this'll do, and we're thankful for the technology that allows this to happen. I don't know if you can see it in the picture there, but we're using the Blue Yeti microphone kind of up over the laptop. It's on a gooseneck stand built up behind it there. And I keep an eye on the clock over my left side here so I can see when we start and about how long we're taking. I learned early on, if you remember back when we discovered this, when we switched microphones, we learned that we had to completely shut down the HVAC system in our house. No air conditioning, no heat for the 45 minutes or whatever that I'm working on class, because there is a heat vent right over this setup here that was blowing right on the microphone. And it wasn't a problem until we got a better microphone, and then it was picking up everything, kind of sounded like thunder. I think some of you said your dogs were especially scared, not just of me, but I'm sure it was the thunder. So we've learned to turn that off. So that was a learning experience. I got a black sheet hanging behind me here so that that my office is not a distraction for you. And you can't see them in this picture here, but the lights in the office, they were salvaged from the deconstruction store over on the east side, behind the east side Walmart. And they salvaged those from the Mott's paint building off of West Wash, or East Wash, I guess it is, when that was torn down a number of years back. And I follow along in my notes these days on my phone, which is kind of propped up against my screen here. So I've kind of got the weird bifocal thing going on here, but it's the best we could do, and it's been working. And thank you for your patience there. But I just thought you may want to see kind of a behind the scenes what's going on here, and since we're not able to be together in person. Tonight we are concluding our study of the book of Acts. As I said before, this is the book of gospel action written by Luke, the beloved physician, to a man named Theophilus, giving him a history of the early church. And since he's addressed as Most Excellent Theophilus, some have assumed that he might have been some kind of government official, because that's how government officials were referred to back then. And so if that is the case, then Luke seems to be giving this man some reassurance that the church is not out to overthrow the Roman Empire, but the church is a spiritual kingdom as opposed to some kind of an earthly kingdom that was a threat to the Roman Empire. By way of review, for the last time for a while in the ABCs of Acts, we've assigned a successive letter of the alphabet for each chapter, and then starting over again with A and B for the last 2 chapters. But up to this point, we've looked at the ascension, the beginning of the church, carried and cured. That was a good change made from this class. So this time through is how we changed that. It used to be cripple cured. Obviously, cripple was not ideal. And so I'm very thankful to one of our good Christian sisters for coming up with this one. A good addition I will remember for the rest of my life. Carried and cured. The man was carried by his friends, laid at the gate there, and he was cured. Determined disciples in chapter 4. Empty jail. First deacons with a question mark. Great hero. How can I? I am Jesus, journey to Joppa, kingdom includes Gentiles, liberated again, missionary sent out, not gods but men. The old law is not binding in chapter 15, chapter 16, Philippian jailer converted, questions answered in Athens, reasoning with the preacher, saving our religious friends, Troas on the Lord's Day, uproar in Jerusalem, valuable citizenship, waiting to kill Paul, the excuses of Felix, yet untried by Caesar, zealous toward God, arriving safely on shore. And then tonight in the last chapter, we are back to being with Christians in Rome. Over the past few chapters, we've seen Paul travel from Caesarea across the Mediterranean Sea. He has shipwrecked on Malta, and now he's made his way up to the city of Rome. And that is our summary of Acts chapter 28, being with Christians in Rome. Last week, you may remember, I shared a picture of our family with the church in Rome, taken on a Wednesday evening, January 2nd, 2008. We were there in Germany to visit family in the Air Force at that time. We took a quick trip down to Rome, and this was truly a highlight of the trip. And so tonight, Paul is also in Rome. So being with Christians in Rome, and that brings us up to where we are. So let's pick up tonight with Acts 28, and our first paragraph is verses 16 through 22. Acts 28, 16 through 22. When we entered Rome, Paul was allowed to stay by himself with the soldier who was guarding him. After 3 days, Paul called together those who were the leading men of the Jews, and when they came together, he began saying to them, "Brethren, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. And when they had examined me, they were willing to release me because there was no ground for putting me to death. But when the Jews objected, I was forced to appeal to Caesar. Not that I had any accusation against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I requested to see you and to speak with you, for I am wearing this chain for the sake of the hope of Israel." They said to him, "We have neither received letters from Judea concerning you, nor have any of the brethren come here and reported or spoken anything bad about you. But we desire to hear from you what your views are, for concerning this sect, it is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere." So this is where we are. We are here in this passage in Acts 28, 16 through 22. Let's start up in verse 16. And we're dealing with Paul's living conditions in Rome. So they didn't have huge prisons back then. They did have soldiers. They had a lot of soldiers. And so it was generally cheaper, just as effective, just to let the prisoner stay on his own, but to chain him to a soldier. In a sense, we kind of do this today, don't we? Only instead of a soldier, we use a GPS ankle monitor. We got the bracelet that's worn. In my mind, this is pretty much what's going on here. Paul hasn't been convicted of anything yet. He's not a violent criminal. There are no violent even accusations against him. If you remember, Paul is the one who appealed to Caesar. So this is not Caesar's idea. Caesar didn't say, "Hey, go get this guy, bring him here for trial for some terrible thing he's done." That's not it at all. But in fact, every official he's seen up to this point has declared him not guilty. So he's only here for his own protection, so he wouldn't be sent back to Jerusalem to face a very unfair trial at the hands of the Jews who were out to kill him. And so instead of putting him in prison, the Romans simply assign him a guard, and Paul is then allowed to live on his own. And we'll get back to this at the very end of this chapter. I should also point out that verse 16 is the last "we" passage in the book of Acts. So we've been noting these passages. There are a few of these scattered throughout the kind of the last half of the book. So if the book of Acts has a "we" passage in it, when we entered Rome, what does that indicate? Well, if you remember, Luke is the author, and so that means that Luke is along for the ride here. So Luke is here. But since this is the last of the "we" passages, this probably indicates that Luke leaves at some point and leaves Paul there in Rome. So as far as Luke is concerned, his mission is accomplished. He has Been able to accompany Paul to Rome. He's probably there for support, helping him through maybe some health struggles or whatever. But Luke's job is done and he moves on to something else. And Paul has now connected with his Christian family there in the city of Rome. Starting in verse 17, Paul, basically in captivity, calls together the leading men of the Jews. He cannot go to them, but he can get them to come to him. How does that work? Well, if Paul is confined to his rented room, how does he get the word out? Well, I think we need to remember that Paul has been accompanied by at least not just Luke, but also Aristarchus. We learn this back in Acts 27, verse 2, as Luke refers to getting on the ship along with Aristarchus. So that was a Macedonian man from Thessalonica. And there are a number of others. If we piece it together, I think there are a few other names we can throw in here. I think Timothy may visit at some point during this two-year period. John Mark may as well, at least he's referred to. I'd have to look that up again, but there are a number of people that Paul knows who are here, even though Luke might have left by this point. But in Rome, his friends are out there running errands. Maybe Luke at the beginning, Aristarchus here continuing on, and they're getting his food, they're bringing him supplies. And now they're out there lining up people for visits, and that seems to be what happens here. So Paul assembles the leading Jewish men, and he starts with them. This is his number one mission at this point. And to me, it seems to be really the most respectful thing, I think, for Paul to do here. So he doesn't just start with anybody. He doesn't just call in random Jewish people off the street, but he starts with the leadership. So he doesn't go with the rank and file. He goes with the Jewish leading men. And so as I see it, he starts at the top, doesn't he? He doesn't bypass the chain of command. He doesn't subvert anything, but he starts with the leaders, and he's not like going behind their backs in terms of leadership at this point. So he starts with the leading men. So starting in the middle of verse 17, he explains why he's in Rome. He lays it all out, how he got here, why he's there, and so on. I've done nothing wrong. I was delivered as a prisoner into the hands of the Romans. When they found me innocent, they were about to let me go, but the Jews objected, so I was forced to appeal to Caesar, and here I am. So I am now ready to appeal to Caesar. And notice how Paul is as nice as possible here. He refers to our father, so that's like our common heritage here. And as to those who objected to him being released, notice he doesn't refer to them as you people, you know, not you Jewish corrupt whatever officials, but he refers to the Jews. So not you, but them over there in Jerusalem. They are the ones who had a problem. And so now that he's in Rome, he's requested to speak with these men because he is wearing this chain for the sake of the hope of Israel. And I know we don't see too many people in chains these days, unless you're in a particular line of work at the county jail. We do run into prisoners from time to time, I guess, out in public. I think a few weeks ago I referred to sitting in the ER with somebody and noticing a prisoner sitting across from us for an hour or two there with the officer. So he had the handcuffs on, waiting for some kind of medical treatment. I remember doing a funeral down in Janesville, and I think it was the son of the Christian woman that I was doing the funeral for. He was in the county jail for some reason. And that's the only funeral I ever did, as far as I know, where we had armed sheriff's deputies standing at every exit to that building. But they allowed the man to come to his mom's funeral, and I'd never seen that happen personally, but there was a man in chains, or in cuffs, we might say, but he was there for a reason, and they made sure he was taken care of. So if Paul is wearing a chain for the sake of the hope of Israel, it certainly only makes sense to start with Israel. And here they are. He's dealing with these Jewish leading men. And that certainly fits in with what Paul has written elsewhere. If you have a hard copy of the Bible, or if you're on a device, if you just scroll one page down, or just one little section over, just keep going to Romans chapter 1, verse 16. So from Acts 28 to Romans 1. And in Romans 1:16, Paul said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." Paul's practice then has been to start with the Jews, and that is exactly what he does here. He starts with the Jewish leaders. In verse 21, these men have no clue whatsoever. They haven't heard anything personally concerning Paul, nothing bad concerning him as an individual. These particular men are what we might describe as being a blank slate in terms of Paul. And really, this has been true for many of Paul's travels. From place to place to place, Paul will go in to preach, they'll listen, But then somebody from his past will show up. They'll start riling people up. And right here at this moment in time, though, these men, they are listening to Paul with an open mind. In fact, in verse 22, they appear to be quite eager. But we desire to hear from you what your views are for concerning this sect. It is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere. And so they do know something about the Christian faith. They know something is going on. They see it as a sect. It is a division of Judaism, as far as they're concerned, but they're open to learning about it. They want to know more, and so they invite Paul to say some words. They do know that it is spoken against, so they know there have been some bad words spoken against the Christian faith, or against this sect in particular. And from history, we know some of the accusations that were made. What if I go around telling everybody that God will destroy the world by fire? What if that's what I'm known for? And I just go around on street corners yelling, you know, God's going to burn everything. Everything's going to be destroyed by fire. What might people start saying about our religious group? Well, those are some dangerous people. They're kind of messed up there. They are arsonists. You know, they're the ones. They're going to start the world on fire, something like that. So you can see that's not the truth, but you can see how that got started. What if I go around talking about eating the body of a man and drinking the blood of this man named Jesus? Or what if an outsider comes and hears us talking about that, eating the body and the blood of a man named Jesus? What might people say about us? Bunch of cannibals in that group over there, bunch of weirdos. This is some strange stuff we're hearing. They're eating the body and the blood of some guy. Also, what if I go around talking about being married to my sister? Aren't I married to my sister? Well, yeah, I could address her as sister. I am her brother. But of course, if that starts getting around, we got some other issues going on, don't we? So I think you can see that it's very easy for the church to be spoken against. And so if people take things out of context, or if they just hear little bits and pieces here and there, I think we understand that there is some gossip going around. And so this is a group that was spoken against in the ancient world. But these leaders, though, they at least say that they are open to learning. So they don't cut it off at that point, but they're patient. They're willing to at least listen to Paul. So let's pick up with Acts 28. Verses 23 through 29, Acts 28, 23 through 29. When they had set a day for Paul, they came to him at his lodging in large numbers, and he was explaining to them by solemnly testifying about the kingdom of God and trying to persuade them concerning Jesus from both the law of Moses and from the prophets from morning until evening. Some were being persuaded by the things spoken, but others would not believe. And when they did not agree with one another, they began leaving after Paul had spoken one parting word. The Holy Spirit rightly spoke through Isaiah the prophet to your fathers, saying, go to this people and say, you will keep on hearing but will not understand, and you will keep on seeing but will not perceive. For the heart of this people has become dull, and with their ears they scarcely hear, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and return, and I would heal them. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will also listen. When he had spoken these words, the Jews departed, having a great dispute among themselves. Well, notice starting in verse 23, they set a day, they come to Paul in large numbers. They give him a chance to explain, and he does. He solemnly testifies about the kingdom of God. He tries to convince them concerning Jesus. He does this by appealing to the scriptures. So this isn't all about Paul. This is how God changed my life. I mean, sometimes he would go that way, but in this case, he keeps it really close to the scripture. He appeals to the word of God. He reasons both from the law of Moses and from the prophets, from what we would commonly refer to today as being the Old Testament. And he does this from morning until evening. It is a long day. While we're on this, I would also just invite you to imagine being the Roman soldier chained to Paul for all of this. We don't have the guy's name. I think we will know the guy's name at some point. I hope that we will. And we'll get back to that in just a moment. But just keep this in mind. Imagine being the guy chained to the Apostle Paul as large numbers of people come in to hear Paul teaching. I mean, you would be getting a bigger dose of the gospel than pretty much anybody else in the history of the gospel, and you would see it from an inside perspective. I mean, you know, imagine being at the preacher's house on Sunday night after the exhausting day. Well, the soldier's still there. And so as Paul and his friends review what happened, I mean, that soldier would be there. He would be there to hear all of it, the reasoning from the scriptures, the behind the scenes, Paul's struggles. They would get to know each other. In the middle here, we find that some are persuaded among the Jewish leadership. Others refuse to believe. So it's not just that Paul failed to convince them. It's that they made a decision not to believe this. So they refused to believe. And this is what happens when the gospel is proclaimed. It brings us to the point of making a decision. Either we believe and obey, or we refuse to believe. And that's a choice that all of us have the freedom to make. And I would emphasize here that this isn't Paul's fault at all. This is no failure on his part. Paul does his job by taking the word of God to the Jewish leadership. And to drive this home to those who are listening, he quotes Isaiah. And Jesus quotes the same passage from Isaiah back in Matthew 13, verses 14 and 15, I believe. And the message from Isaiah is basically a reminder that even God's own people have a long history of not listening. And that seems to be something that seems to run in the family, not in a genetic sense by any means, but this has always been a challenge. And it's a challenge for us today, isn't it? I mean, we're not guaranteed to listen to and accept everything we hear in terms of the gospel. It's a challenge. We got to make the choice. And a lot of times we choose wrongly. And by the way, not just for the Jewish people, but really everybody. And again, just like us today as well. So all of us have a tendency to not listen from time to time. We're free to choose. And we often choose to ignore the message. And that's Paul's reminder to these Jewish leaders that God addressed this, you know, 700 years ago through the prophet Isaiah. This, by the way, is basically Paul's summary of how he's been received after 20 to 30 years of preaching. This summarizes the whole book of Acts, doesn't it? He's traveled all over the Mediterranean world. He's been beaten. He's been left for dead. He's suffered shipwreck. He's preached to natives on islands. He's preached everywhere. And it all boils down to this. A lot of people ultimately will not listen to the gospel message. Just another quick note on the quote from Isaiah. In the middle of verse 25, Paul attributes this quote to the Holy Spirit speaking through Isaiah. So let's just be clear on that. This passage comes from God himself, but God the Spirit was speaking through the prophet. So these words are ultimately from God. And that, of course, kind of reaffirms the inspired authorship of the book of Isaiah. At this point, as he's done over and over again through the years, Paul explains that he will now turn his attention to the Gentiles. So again, from Romans 1:16 to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. We do have a textual note on verse 29 indicating it is not in the oldest manuscripts. I know we've discussed this before. Most of the manuscripts we have today are copies of copies. For the most part, they are virtually identical. Scribes took their work just incredibly seriously. They did amazing work. They are just almost like photocopies. I mean, we have an extremely high degree of certainty that what we have is the original that the authors actually wrote. But this, though, here in verse 29 is one of those very rare occasions where we have something that probably wasn't in the original document. In my opinion, I'm glad we have it in brackets here, so at least we know about it. And I'm glad that it's in brackets. You know, if it was unbracketed with no explanation, we would think that verse 29 was absolutely positively the word of God. But I'm at least glad that we have a footnote in the brackets there to explain what's going on here. And what also impresses me, I guess what I'm thankful for, this is not some doctrinally critical issue. This isn't the necessity of baptism in this verse. This is not some worship matter. But I think it does reflect what probably actually happened here. I don't think 29 is a wrong statement. When he had spoken these words, the Jews departed, having a great dispute among themselves. I mean, that is what happened here, isn't it? In fact, he refers to that back up in verse 24. But I'm just saying that if you don't have verse 29 in your Bible, don't get too concerned about that, but just note that there is some dispute over the authenticity of that little sentence there. Well, let's conclude tonight with Acts 28, verses 30 and 31. Acts 28, 30 and 31. And he stayed 2 full years in his own rented quarters, and was welcoming all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ, with all openness unhindered. In verse 30, we get plugged back into the timeline. This goes on for 2 years. which probably indicates that he was released at the end of 2 years. Maybe the Jewish people from Caesarea, Jerusalem never came, never presented the charges. There was nothing to it. Maybe he did face Caesar and he was dismissed, but for whatever reason, he's there for 2 years. It's not a permanent confinement. We didn't know this earlier in the chapter, but now we know Paul is in a rental. So we knew he was somewhere. Now we know this is his rented place. And this would also remind us that this is cheaper for Rome. So not only do they not have a huge prison, but under these circumstances, the prisoner has to pay for his own lodging. Again, very similar to our GPS ankle monitor setup these days. It's cheaper, and that really gets down to a matter of money. Then we also have the reminder in the very last verse that this arrangement allows Paul to continue preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ with all openness unhindered. And I just love that the last word in Acts is unhindered, in our English translations at least. I didn't look it up in Greek, but in English at least, unhindered, that's the last word, and that's just awesome. And I know it's easy to think back over the past 28 chapters here and kind of to see a lot of hindrances in the book of Acts. Haven't we seen some hindrances? We've seen Peter and John arrested, we've seen multiple disciples arrested, put to death even, you got Stephen stoned, and Paul's life was a history of being chased down from one place to another and so on. And sometimes, though, the church grew because of the hindrances, didn't it? And I kind of take that out of that last verse. The church is growing. The gospel is spreading in an unhindered kind of way. Not that there were never obstacles, but when there were, even those obstacles, God was able to use for the benefit of his kingdom. And I think of Saul himself persecuting the church back in Acts chapter 8. You know, what did that do? All that did was send Christians to far-off places where they continued preaching and teaching the gospel. And so because of Saul, even before he obeyed the gospel, he was spreading the gospel. That obviously was not his intent, but that is the reality of it. So anyway, the gospel continues to spread unhindered. And I guess it's a little bit strange. It's kind of a weird way to end the book. But again, Luke has accomplished his mission. I don't know whether you remember this, but we started our study of Acts back on March 17th, 2021. That was about 10 months ago. And way back then, I suggested a very rough outline of this book based on what Jesus said to the apostles right before his ascension in Acts 1 verse 8. He said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and even to the remotest part of the earth." And so this has been our outline. The gospel will spread from Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria, and then to the remotest parts of the earth. In Acts 1 through 7, we looked at the spread of the gospel in Jerusalem, from the 12 apostles to multiple thousands upon thousands. In Acts 8 through 11, the gospel then spreads to Judea and Samaria. We got Philip preaching in Samaria and so on. And then finally, from Acts 11 through 28, the gospel has now spread to the remotest parts of the earth. So from Jerusalem to Rome, and the gospel is still continuing to spread even from there. Before we wrap this up, I wanted to go back to our study sheet on the major events in the life of Paul, compiled and arranged by Dowell Flatt, who was a good teacher I had many years ago. And I've said many times, this is one of the most valuable pieces of paper I ever obtained in my college education. I've referred to this many, many, many times through the years. A number of the Bibles I've had through the years, I've reduced this on the copier and taped it inside the back cover. It is a valuable, valuable tool. But I'm zooming in on the years here at the end of Acts just to make sure we are still aware of the timeline, to make sure we're plugged in, that this is some a real book, real events happen in real places with real people. So Paul is arrested in Jerusalem in 57 AD. He's imprisoned in Caesarea for just over 2 years, from 57 to 59 AD. He then spends 2 years under house arrest in Rome. That's the passage that we've studied tonight. This takes place then from 60 to 62 AD. But what I really want us to notice is that as Paul is in Rome for these 2 years, he actually writes four books of the New Testament: Philemon, Colossians, Ephesians, and Philippians. And so he uses his time in Rome not only to study with people in person, but also he uses that time to write. And these four books are known as Paul's prison epistles. And I do find it interesting that They were not actually written from prison, were they? We've discussed this tonight. They were not written from prison, even though they're called the prison epistles. They were not written from prison. They were written from his rented apartment. I suppose the rented apartment epistles does not quite have the same ring to it. So we kind of go with the prison epistles, but I think we need to look at that with the understanding that he wasn't in prison as we would understand it. He wasn't in prison as he was for the book of 2 Timothy, which was prison, like dungeon kind of prison. But he is writing these four books from his rented apartment, chained to a Roman soldier somewhere in the city of Rome. Way back in one of my preaching classes, I remember preaching from Philippians. And in that sermon I wrote for the class to be evaluated, I remember preaching from Philippians. And I remember in that sermon talking about Paul writing and how it was so amazing that he was writing such a cheerful letter as he was rotting away in a cold, dark Roman prison cell and on, you know, milking it for all it's worth. And the professor corrected me on that, and I'm thankful for it. And, you know, although it is referred to as a prison epistle, it was not actually written from prison, but it was written from an apartment. And Paul expressed hope in the book of Philippians. It was not all doom and gloom in that letter. There was hope for getting out, and that's even seen in that letter. And the word joy, I think, is used 16, 18 times, something like that, in that book. So I think that kind of reminds us this was not a doom and gloom type scenario as 2 Timothy was. So it's a different tone because it's a different imprisonment. There were two Roman imprisonments, the apartment and then the prison later on. Speaking of Philippians, he also seems to have converted at least some of his guards. It's not a rock solid nail your faith down on that, but there's some interesting passages at the beginning of Philippians 1, 12 through 14. This is what he says. Now I want you to know, brethren, that my circumstances have turned out for the greater progress of the gospel, so that my imprisonment in the cause of Christ has become well known throughout the whole Praetorian Guard and to everyone else, and that most of the brethren, trusting in the Lord because of my imprisonment, have far more courage to speak the word of God without fear. Okay, that was written from his rented apartment. Well, by the time we get to the end of the book of Philippians, he says in Philippians 4:22, I think that's next to the last verse, he says, all the saints greet you, especially those of Caesar's household. That's an interesting little reference. And as I see it, as he's writing to the church in Philippi, he's basically saying at the end of his letter, oh, by the way, Caesar's personal bodyguards, your new Christian brothers, told me to tell you hello. And I'm just mentioning this to emphasize that Paul is truly continuing to preach the gospel in an unhindered kind of way. And that gets back to, imagine being this guy chained to the Apostle Paul. He's chained to one arm, and his other arm is writing letters like Philippians and Colossians and Ephesians and Philemon. So as to Paul's future at this point, he's released after 2 years. He might have gone to Spain, as he was hoping to do in Romans 15, 24, and 25. He then writes the books of Titus and 1 Timothy between 62 and 67. He is eventually arrested again in 67 AD. He writes the book of 2 Timothy, which I said, again, it is from an actual prison. We actually visited what is believed to be that prison in the city of Rome while we were there. And Paul is in some serious trouble on that second imprisonment, under arrest, not because he appealed to Caesar, but because of something he did, preaching the gospel. The emperor was upset at that and wants him to come in, and so he was most likely executed at some point around 68 AD. The end of Acts, though, is very positive. Paul is preaching. He's teaching from his own rented apartment, unhindered. Some, by the way, have suggested that we are now living in Acts 29. And that is a neat way of putting that. There is no Acts 29 in the Bible, but in a sense, we are living now in a continuation of this book. And I appreciate that. We are the church of Acts 29, we'll leave it there until maybe we study this book again, maybe 20 years from now. I don't know if we're on a 20-year cycle now or what. I don't think we're sticking to the order that we studied these before, but 20 years from now, I'll be probably around 70 years old if I make it that long. So I don't know. I'm not making any plans. But anyway, I'm hoping to head toward a study of the book of Genesis. That's where I want us to go. It's a good book. We haven't studied for many, many years. I'm heading out of town for the first week of February, though, for the Fried Hardeman lecture, so I'm not sure whether we'll just jump right into Genesis next week or maybe do a shorter study before we get there. That's kind of what I'm leaning toward. I hate to start a new book right before going out of town for a couple weeks. If you have ideas on that, let me know, but I may be looking for a very short book or a very short topical study that we could do for a week or two before we jump right into all 50 chapters in the book of Genesis. So thank you for taking the time to study together over the past 10 months, and thank you for being here tonight. I hope all of you could be present for worship on Sunday at 9 and 11, and also for class in between at 10. Let me know if you have anything that we need to be praying about. But let's close tonight by going to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, you are the one and only God, a God of grace and mercy. We're especially thankful tonight for Luke, and thank you for this book giving us a history of your church. We're thankful for its historical accuracy. We're thankful for what it teaches us about Peter and Paul and their lives and what they did and their sermons and what they said and their friends and all of that, Father. Thank you. We're thankful for those who have gone on before us, who have given us some good tools for understanding what we've studied over the past year. As we continue living, as we continue writing the history of your church, as we continue teaching your good news to the world around us, Father, we ask for your blessing tonight. We ask for wisdom. We ask for courage. Thank you for making us a part of your kingdom, the church. Thank you for Jesus. We come to you tonight in his name. Amen.